Good morning. Welcome to Andrews United Methodist Church. My name is Robbie Morris, the Director of Family Ministry and Facilities Coordinator. We're glad that you decided to join us this morning. Sorry, we've had some technical difficulties, so we weren't able to do this live. But anyway, we're glad that you joined us. A couple things. Wanted to make sure that you knew that there's going to be a letter go out this week that will explain that an announcement that we our worship services we won't be able to have in person until after June 30th. And Pastor Tom is going to get more information out to you about that. But in the meantime, we'll still be having Facebook live streaming and copies of those videos shown on our YouTube channel as well. So really excited about announcing to you today our graduates in our class of 2020. And we have a video on Facebook that you can watch, a pictorial slideshow of our graduates this year, as well as some other information on Facebook. But I just wanted to share the names of those who will be graduating, and one that's already graduated. Makai Baxter is graduating from Andrews High School. Makai plans to attend Rahman Junior College in the fall to study and play football. Landon Hall is graduating from Robbinsville High School. Landon plans to attend Tri-County Community College in the fall. And then Landon White is graduating from Andrews High School. And Landon plans to attend Tri-County Community College in the fall as well. So also wanted to recognize Alex Stroud, who graduated already from Western Carolina University with a master's in social work. So we just want to celebrate with them. We also want to offer, once we're able to meet in person, we want to be able to do that, have a recognition and celebrate their achievements in person. So we will keep you informed as to when that date will be. It's great to do it online, but it's just not the same as doing it in person. Also wanted to invite you to graduation this week for Andrews High School, Thursday, 6:30, and they're gonna be having a parade down Main Street here, and then they'll march up the hill, up the stairs, and receive their diploma. So we're just excited about that. So if you wanna come and cheer them on, of course we have to observe social distancing, but just wanted to let you know about that. We're also continuing to have a welcome table each week, and this past week I think we served about 70 people total between people coming and our deliveries. So continue to pray for that ministry, and if you want to come and help out, we got plenty of space for that. Also, Gabriel's Meal, just want to remind you, since we're not able to have Gabriel's Meal during this time, but Gabriel still has continuing medical care. And you can bring your donation by the church and drop it off, or you can mail it in to the church office. So I just want to remind the youth and the parents about the stuff that I send out each week with my family ministry newsletter. Resources for you as a parent and as well as the kids. There's downloads in the newsletter that PDF files with Bible studies and devotionals for your kids, as well as links to go watch videos that go along with that curriculum. So some great stuff for you there. We thank you for your faithful giving through the crisis so that our ministries can continue. And you have several donation options. You can drop it off at the church office Monday through Friday between 8 and 12. We're not going to be open tomorrow because of the holiday. But Gene will be here to take that for you. Also mail it in to the church, and we have an online giving portal that is on our website. So if you go on the website, there's a link over there that's for giving purposes. So we're also sending weekly updates out by email. If you're not receiving that, please contact us. So God is good.
All the time.
God is good.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, good morning and welcome to worship here at Andrews Church. As we begin to focus on our time of worship, I invite you to join in the call to worship that's printed in your bulletin. We can do it responsibly with the congregation gathered here and at home reading every other line. So let us join in this call to worship. Risen with Christ, let us seek the realities of the Spirit. Our life is hidden with Christ in God. He who descended is also ascended far above the heavens, that he might fill all things. When Christ our life appears, we shall appear with him in glory. Hallelujah. Amen. Our opening hymn this morning is He is Exalted. It's printed in the sheets that we sent to you. We're going to go through or sing through He is Exalted two times. When we come into the holy presence of God, our own humanity is laid bare. When we stand in the living presence of truth, our own falsehood is revealed. People of God, let us acknowledge who we are and ask our ever-present God to forgive us. Amen. Our first scripture reading this morning comes from the Acts of the Apostles. We'll be reading the first 11 verses of chapter 1. Hear these words that Luke has left for our consideration. Theophilus, the first scroll I wrote concerning everything Jesus did and taught from the beginning, right up to the day when he was taken up into heaven. Before he was taken up, working in the power of the Holy Spirit, Jesus instructed the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he showed them that he was alive with many convincing proofs. He appeared to them over a time of 40 days, speaking to them about God's kingdom. While they were eating together, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for what the Father had promised. He said, "This is what you heard from me. John baptized with water, but in only a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." As a result, those who had gathered together asked Jesus, "Lord, are you going to restore the kingdom of Israel now?" Jesus replied, "It isn't for you to know the times or seasons that the Father has set by his own authority. Rather, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all of Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth." After these things that Jesus said, as they were watching,
Jesus was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. When he was going away, and as they were standing and staring toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood next to them. They said to them, "Galileans, why are you standing here looking toward heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way that you saw him go into heaven." And God add his blessing to this reading of this portion of Holy Word.
There's an old saying that oil and water don't mix. If you take a clear bottle, fill it about one-third full with water, then add some brightly colored food coloring to make it readily visible, then add vegetable oil until the bottle is about two-thirds full. The oil is going to float on top of the water. But when the jar is shaken vigorously, the oil and water will appear to become one. If left to stand for a period of time, though, they will eventually separate back out again. Our verse today from John 17 says, "My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it." This is Jesus' prayer for the disciples before he was crucified. He prayed that as they lived in the world, that they would not become a part of the world. What does that mean? What part of the world does Jesus want us to stay away from? Well, we know that specifically he wants us to stay away from sin, selfishness, unforgiveness, meanness, arrogance, lies, and evil. He wants us to be separated from things like that. He doesn't want us to act like that. He wants us to rise above that. He wants us to be different. We're supposed to be like him, loving, compassionate, pure, peaceful, joyful, unselfish, forgiving, speaking truth, those fruits of the Spirit that we read about in Galatians chapter 5. When we act like Jesus, we add our colorful gifts, just like the food coloring that you pour in the water. They can have an effect on others and lead them to Christ. But sometimes in the world, things can get shaken up. And we can get mixed in with the world. We make mistakes. We're human. But Jesus' prayer for us is that we would be different from the world, separate, just like oil and water. This is another passage of Scripture that refers to this in Romans chapter 12. It says, "Do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." Let's pray. Dear Jesus, help us as we live in this world to remain faithful to your call to be separate from the world. In your name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Robert. It's a time in our service where we pray for one another, and we lift up prayer requests and offer praise reports. And since we are not together physically, I invite you to do that amongst yourselves, wherever you are at this time. This morning, the pastoral prayer will focus on the ultimate sacrifice that so many have given for the freedoms that this country enjoys. It will also remember those who have died in this recent pandemic. So I invite you to join me in prayer. Eternal God, creator of years, of centuries, Lord of whatever is beyond time, maker of all species and master of all history, how shall we speak to you from our smallness and inconsequence? Except that you have called us to worship you in spirit and in truth. You have dignified us with loves and loyalties, without groveling, though we sometimes feel that low. You have lifted us up with your loving kindness, therefore we are bold to come before you without groveling and without fear. We sing with spirit and pray with courage because you have dignified us. You have redeemed us from the aimlessness of things going meaninglessly well. God, lift the hearts of those for whom this holiday is not just a diversion, but a painful memory and continued deprivation. Bless those whose dear ones have died needlessly, wastefully as it seems, in accident, misadventure, or willful disregard. Lord, we remember with compassion those who have died serving their countries in the futility of combat. There is none of us but must come to bereavement and separation when all the answers we are offered fail to question death asks of each of us. We believe that you will provide for us as others have been provided with the fulfillment of blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Holy and gracious God, receive this prayer. Receive the prayers of our hearts. Receive our lives as we offer them to you in the name of Jesus, the risen Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We continue our worship. I invite you to join in affirming what we believe by praying together the modern affirmation that is printed in your bulletin. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. We believe in God, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of God's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ, and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen. And amen. Let us continue to worship God as we offer ourselves in service to God, and as we give thanks for the gifts that God has so graciously blessed us with. Thank you. as we prepare our hearts to hear from the Gospel of Luke. Gospel reading this morning comes from the 24th chapter of Luke, the last verses of Luke's Gospel, beginning in verse 44 and reading through verse 53. Hear these words that Luke has left for us. Jesus said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." And he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. He said to them, "This is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. And a change of heart and life for the forgiveness of sins must be preached in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. Look, I am sending you to what my father promised. I am sending to you what my father promised. But you are to stay in the city until you have been furnished with heavenly power." And he led them out as far as Bethany, where he lifted his hands and blessed them. As he blessed them, he left them and was taken up to heaven. They worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem, overwhelmed with joy. And they were continuously in the temple, praising God. May this be the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, we ask that you would empower us to exercise the freedom that you have given us in Christ Jesus. The intellect, the reason, to honestly consider things that are hard to accept, to believe, but also to find the wisdom and the truth in the stories that are told, so that we might come to know you and the Christ in a deeper, deeper way. And so I pray, gracious God, that the words of my mouth, words that I struggled with, and the meditations of our hearts would be acceptable to you, for you and you alone are our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, from his prison cell, wrote these words on Ascension Day. "Today is Ascension Day," he writes, "and that means that it is a day of great joy for all who can believe that Christ rules the world and our lives." Well, actually, Thursday was Ascension Day, 40 days after Easter, 10 days before Pentecost, which we will celebrate next Sunday. I have never in my memory preached on the Ascension. In many ways, it's complicated and nuanced and as difficult as preaching on the Trinity. And that's so, I think, because our Enlightenment or post-Enlightenment minds struggle with the idea, let alone the reality, that first, a dead human being is resurrected from the dead, not only that, but later that same one is taken into heaven in a mysterious lifting. Luke's gospel chronicles both of these phenomena. But it's interesting that only Luke records the ascension of Jesus. So Luke presents these stories, I think, as not only being true or factual, but perhaps even more important, as being truth. So I want us to consider this morning for a few moments a truth embedded in the story of the ascension of Jesus. Faith asks us to believe Luke's story that the resurrected Jesus, in a final act of visible presence in the earth, ascends or lifts into the heavenly realm from which he came. For first century readers and believers, this might not be a stretch for them. They would certainly remember the story of Elijah. And while Elijah's story is unique in that Elijah did not die, he did ascend to heaven in a whirlwind. So the notion then of one visibly ascending into the heavens might not, like I said, might not be hard for them to, in that day, to believe or to comprehend. We, however, might ask, as so many have and do, if the ascension story told by Luke is factual, or is Luke using a storyteller's embellishment to make a theological point? The problem with focusing on such distinctions is that we often are led off into the tall weeds of speculation, and as we are in those tall weeds, we lose the truth of a story as we insist on it being factual. So our focus this morning requires of us an act of faith. An act of faith equal to Christian belief that the ascension of the Lord did in fact take place. The picture that Luke paints details an action that is truth. As the story goes, Jesus ascends into heaven, and before and as he ascends into heaven, he lifts his hands, he raises his hands, and confers a blessing on the disciples. I want to suggest that the larger truth, or the more inclusive truth of the story, is God's salvation incarnated in Jesus' life, death, and resurrection includes all of humanity in the blessing Jesus shares as he withdraws into heaven. This withdrawal into heaven sets the stage, if you will, for the promised gift of the Holy Spirit, which we will celebrate next week. And if you listened a little to the reading from Acts, you get the flow from Luke's gospel right into Acts as Luke anticipates the coming of the Spirit. That coming of the Spirit is not only the promise of God, but it is the blessing of God. Because that Spirit will remind the disciples, certainly, but all of us, of all the things Jesus taught, and will at the same time empower them and us to live into the fullness of the resurrection. And there's the blessing, right? Will empower us to live into the creative power of God's love, to make something new from something old and tattered. I don't know about you, but I need to be empowered to live into the fullness of the resurrection love of God. Always I need that to be sure, but now it seems more than ever, given the tensions and the diversions and the divisions and all that confront us blessing of God is that God's presence and God's truth and God's love is present to us, with us, and in us, no matter what's going on around us. But I need to be empowered to be reminded of that truth. The blessing of new life that God offers solely, simply because God loves me. I need to be reminded of that, because that is almost as implausible to me as the ascension. It's something that I struggle with, that God could love me so much. Part of that blessing also comes with a bit of a responsibility, I guess, to love as God loves. Not only are we blessed by being loved by God, by being saved, continually saved by God's grace, we are asked, invited to share that love, and to be able to share a love that is almost incomprehensible requires new clothes, a new attitude, and a new focus. The promise of God with us. The late theologian Klaus Westermann posited, and I love this because it is so very true, that God's salvation comes to us in two forms. Though we normally focus on salvation as deliverance, and that it is, salvation is also blessing. He continues, the Exodus and the cross are both deliverance events. We're brought from bondage into freedom. Salvation, as well as deliverance, as blessing, has to do with the ongoing day-to-day power of God that upholds and undergirds life. Salvation is the blessing that brings us peace and well-being. I just want to study on that for a minute. Salvation is so much more than just deliverance, but it's blessing and empowerment to live day to day in peace and well-being. You'll remember, I'm sure, in John's Gospel, where Jesus' words are recorded in his farewell discourse with the disciples. He shared with them that he is going to the Father. And he shares these words that we always, almost always anyway, hear in funeral or memorial services. And there's a phrase in there that is so absolutely beautiful to me. I always stop in the middle of reading it in a funeral service to highlight it. I will not leave you orphaned, Jesus says. Now that's part of the promise of the ascension. I will not leave you orphaned. My peace I leave with you, and I do not give to you as the world gives. I don't give you the kind of peace that the world gives to you. I leave you my peace, so therefore do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. I believe this with all that is within me, that this is the blessing conferred in the story that Luke shares in the ascension of the risen Christ. A blessing of peace, but also a blessing and promise of the one who can and does make that peace a reality in our lives. But here's the other side. The blessing, like salvation, is kind of twofold. Not only are we given the blessing, not only are we allowed to receive the blessing, we are asked to share the blessing. And I think perhaps that may be the greater blessing of the two, because it allows us to not only focus on that which God has done in us and for us, but what God might do through us as we share the blessing that we have received from God with others. There again, the focus of Jesus' understanding of the whole of the law and prophets, to love God and to love neighbor as ourselves. Jesus reminds the disciples that what they experienced with him and of him is that which they have been tasked to share with others. He says to them, remember, this is what was written in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms. This is what is written about me that points to me. And because of that, not only that, but because you have spent time with me, you know me intimately. I wonder if the disciples are not much like us. We know of Jesus, but sometimes knowing of Jesus does not necessarily mean that we know Jesus. Perhaps they knew him better than they realized. But Jesus reminds them that the hope of God's salvation and blessing as recorded in the Hebrew Scriptures is God's blessing and love for all people of all times. You are witnesses to these things, he says to the disciples, which includes you and me. And these things are to be proclaimed in my name to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem, or otherwise beginning at home. You've been given the blessing. You've also been given the blessing to be able to share what God has given to you with others. As children of God, all receive a blessing of love from God every moment of every day. God's love and blessing are not the property of any one religion or faith perspective. God's love is universal. We may not be as aware of that blessing as we should, and we may even take it for granted. However, we who claim the Christ believe that God's love and blessing became flesh and lived among us should be givers and sharers of that love and blessing to our neighbor. For just as you and me, our neighbors need to hear, they need to see and experience the blessing of God in Christ Jesus. They need to hear and see and experience the power of the blessing of God's love to give hope. They need to see and feel and experience hope, real hope, when life turns upside down, when yesterday's certainty is today's uncertainty, when a need for the word of comfort is met with fear-filled rhetoric. I ask you to think of the world in disarray and the need, the desire of the people for a word of hope and blessing. Not only the world at large, but the nation and even the church. We need to hear a word of hope and blessing. Jesus blessed us all as he returned to the Father. But for many, and maybe for many of us who have been a part of the church for all our life, for many, the promise of hope conferred in Jesus' blessings to the disciples and to us is as difficult to believe as the ascension story itself. And yet truth, the truth of hope revealed in the Christ among us, is real and factual and is witnessed to in the lives and actions of those whose faith allows us to see beyond the illusion of truth which the world puts forth, and the truth of the blessing of God's eternal presence and the promised blessing of hope for all people. May we be disciples who witness the ascension of hope over fear, the ascension of life over death. May we speak that truth into a world so desperately needing to be lifted up. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And amen. As we respond to the word read and the word spoken, let us join in our closing hymn, Praise to the Lord the Almighty. We're going to sing verses 1, 4, and 5. You have those words printed in your bulletin. Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen.